If you want to make the world a better place, take a look at yourself and make that change. Change. Na 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 na.
Hi, I'm Xiaoyin. And this is my story in all of its messy glory. I was born in 1977, and I was a very typical middle child. Okay, I was full of insecurities, I was full of fears, I was scared of everything you can think of, right? I was scared of losing money, I was scared of standing out, I was scared of speaking in front of a lot of people, I was scared of being wrong, I was scared of taking a risk. I'm the last person you would think should be an entrepreneur. In fact, that was never ever a dream of mine, right? Understandably. And also for a person with a lot of fears, you probably don't make a lot of choices. So I never really made a lot of active choices in my life. My life was pretty much chosen for me. I would coast along with whatever choices were made for me, and I was quite happy because it's very safe that way. I was very secure that way. And that's how I managed to end up in junior college at 18, right? Not knowing what exactly I wanted. I was doing well in school. But when it came to university applications, and they have like those horrible essays where they ask you, what's your dream? Tell us in 200 words, right? I had no answer, right? At that time, my answer honestly was, I don't have a dream, but I can tell you what I don't want. I don't want to be a Shenton Way drone. I don't want to wear boring office clothes. I don't want to sit in an office cubicle with fluorescent lights. I don't want all of those stuff. That was my dream, as far as I could tell. And so I decided I want to go to art school, not because I liked art, but because it sounded the least corporate of routes. And of course, my parents, being very typical Singaporean Chinese parents, thought that was a terrible idea, right? There was no money to be made in art. And they convinced me to choose architecture. So I ended up in the School of Architecture, not because I loved it, but because it was convenient. And people were nice, and I could learn to like it, right? And if nothing happened, I could very well have just gone along and become a pretty substandard, mediocre, and secretly happy but unhappy architect. That could have been my life. Except what happened was that in 1997, at the age of 20, a series of very strange events happened to me. And for the first time in my life, I was forced to choose. And I had to ask myself, should I choose to believe there is a God? Should I choose to believe that there is a life that is bigger and beyond me, that life is not all about me, and my fears and my neuroses and my insecurities, right? But life is meant to be lived large for other people, to give meaning and to give value, right? And your fears were keeping you down from doing all of that. And I chose to say yes to those questions. And so while I'm sorting out all of these like existential questions to myself, right, it doesn't change the fact that I'm still in architecture school. So honestly, my first serious question to God, right, was, okay, do you want me to be an architect? Because why don't you choose for me and I will suck it up because you're God and I'm not, right? And, right, I didn't get an answer from the sky because it just doesn't happen that way. What I did get an answer was my dad sneakily went to apply for a very prestigious architectural internship for me in America. And I took it up and I thought, okay, fine, that's my answer, right? I'm supposed to be an architect and I will suck it up. Okay. So yeah, so I went to the States and it was a fantastic internship. I earned a decent sum of money. I made a lot of friends and yeah, I was prepared to sort of live it out. Except I had a very small lunchtime conversation with a colleague that really shifted my perspective as well. Right? She just asked me, so after your internship is done, so she's an American, after your internship is done, what are you going to do? And I gave her my stock standard Singaporean answer, right? I said, okay, after my internship, I'm going to go back, I'm going to get my master's in architecture, and then I'll get a job, and then, I don't know, maybe I'll think about what I want to do. And if I had given that answer in like practical Singapore, right, I would have been like, oh yeah, that sounds very good idea, right? but because I was in America, which is the land of like the crazy people, right? They said, oh, okay. So if you already know that you don't want to do it, then why are you still doing it? And I thought, you're right. Why didn't I see that before? That is so strange, but you're completely right. It made so much sense. Why should I continue? And so, to the great horror of my parents, right, I I told them, I'm not going to finish my master's. And to make sure they didn't freak out any further, I told them that I was applying to UCLA for a master's in computer animation. And I did send an application, and I got a place. Again, not because I cared about computer animation, but because it was just I had to have something to tell my parents, right? And okay, and so I had 6 months to enter UCLA, and I came back to Singapore to sort of wait it out. So I was back in Singapore in the year 2000. And I tell you, there was no better time to be back, to be young, and with no plan, and to be completely open, because the year 2000 was the year of the dot-com, right? The year where nobody understood what the internet was, and everyone was throwing buckets of money at any young person, because they assumed that if you were young, you probably knew something about computers and could run a dot-com, right? So there I was, back home, okay? I was 23, I had no experience, and I suddenly had two offers come up to me. Both offers were, do you want to be a creative director of dot-com, right? And I was thinking, wow, up to now, I only use the computer for emailing, but okay, I'm sure I can pick up something. And it was a very simple choice to me. I could either go to UCLA and get my animation degree and not aggro my parents, okay? Or I could be a creative director in two dot-coms, like which sounded cooler, and I thought, oh, it's a pretty obvious choice, right? I'll go for the cool choice. And that's what I did, right? So I did that for 2 years. It was a fantastic time learning. It was the best master's degree, like in real life, that I could get. But one of the best things I learned at the end of the 2 years was, it was still not what I wanted to do. It was fun, but it wasn't what I wanted to do. And so, to the horror of my parents again, I said, "Okay, I'm going to quit the two dot-coms, and I think I'll be a freelance graphic designer and website builder, and you know, think about what I want to do, right?" And luckily for me, there was another conversation that happened, right? An old school friend who was a trainee teacher at that point said he was seeing a market gap and a social gap. He said the social gap you're seeing is, in Singapore, we all know, young people graduate out of the education system. It doesn't matter if you get an A or an F, you're pretty much self-centered. You only cared about your own success. And there was no world beyond Singapore or even beyond your own life. And he said, I'm starting to teach this subject called general paper, and it's awesome. You can talk to them about what's right, what's wrong, what's the big picture and all that, and they have to listen to you because they have to pass, right? They can't go to university without knowing all of these things. And what's fantastic is that no one is really offering GP tuition out there. So wouldn't it be so cool, right, if we started an experimental tuition program that taught GP in a socially conscious way? And I thought, it sounds pretty cool, it sounds pretty fun. But more importantly, it sounded really meaningful to me. So I was thinking, okay, freelance graphic designer figuring out what they want to do, or go and help this like cool, new, interesting, experimental thing, and thought, okay, choice is obvious, do the meaningful thing. And so that's how we started. We started a school of thought in the year 2002, and it really started off with just 20 kids in a smelly little basement, right? And we made tons of mistakes, right, teaching them in the first year, but we were doing enough right that by the end of the year, we had 100 kids, and we felt this is worth putting some serious money into. So there were five of us friends, we each took out $8,000 and started a proper school with $40,000 capital, right? And bear in mind, all of my friends were still full-time teachers within the system, so I was the only one who could legally still sign documents and have it all in my name, right? And while it was fun and was very meaningful and all that, it was a pretty insecure time for me, especially with my parents wondering what I was going to quit next, right? So, yeah, poor parents, right? So I was thinking, what if my friends decide not to leave their cushy jobs and then I'm stuck, you know, the one untrained teacher holding this like strange school, right? And at that point of time, okay, it was in 2005, when there was a decision that I had to make. I had to re-sign the lease of the school, and that meant 3 more years. And I was thinking, you know, being a pastor or a missionary is kind of cool too. Maybe I should go into seminary. And at the beginning of the year, I asked one of the pastors that I knew who was a former teacher, and I asked him, how do you know when you should switch? And he said, you're not going to like my answer. It's not going to be very helpful, but here it is. You know when you know. And then I said, yeah, you're right. It's not very helpful at all, right? But he was right. Because in that same year, I forgot I asked that question, but in that same year, I had a group of really amazing kids. They were not the top tier schools, but they were so ready to learn. And at the end of the year, after the A-level exams was over, right, they were telling me, like, Ms. Kuik, the exams are over, we still want to keep coming for tuition, but our parents won't pay for tuition when there's no exam. So we want to learn stuff. And I said, that's fine, I'll teach you guys for free. Tell me exactly what you want to learn, right? And they said, and their answer just blew me away, right? They said, we want to know what's good, what's evil, why there's suffering, and what we can do. And I thought, that's my answer. I know when I know, right? It was clear to me that you could do good in business. And so I chose to stick it out. And I was glad I did, because surely, sure enough, one by one, my partners, they left their job and they joined me, and it was great. And in the year 2007, we were all thinking, okay, it's time to sort of consolidate all of the stuff that we're teaching, right? And we're thinking, like typical teachers, let's do a textbook and workbook. We sat down for editorial sessions, and we were so incredibly bored by our own like discussions, right? We're like, oh, come on, this is so boring. Who wants to do a textbook? It would be so much more fun if we were like planning like the next Time or the next Newsweek, like a current affairs magazine. That's fun. And we're thinking, yeah, actually, why not? If all of us do 1 year, write and design in-house, self-distribute, right, but we all don't take salary, right, and if we can just sell 800 copies just to pay for publishing, right, why not? And so we thought, okay, it's a risk, let's try that out. Now, if we haven't created enough trouble for ourselves, right, in that very same year, as we were looking for extra classroom spaces, we came upon a unit on the ground floor of North Bridge Road. And it's a fantastic unit, full glass walls, 100 people walk by an hour. We signed a lease on that. And then we thought, it's kind of stupid to put a classroom in there. Who wants to like, you know, pass by and see like a teacher teaching, right? We thought, the most sensible thing you would put in that thing is a restaurant. And then we thought, okay, what does the school have to do with a restaurant? And we thought, well, we've always wanted to broaden the perspective of students and teachers, but the general public will never feel connected to what we do. So we thought, you know, a restaurant might be an interesting experiment in doing that. And, you know, so why not? We asked around everybody, like experienced restaurateurs and all that, what they thought, and they all universally said, don't do it. You will close shop in 1 or 2 years, and it's just a nightmare. Don't do it. You will fail. And we thought, okay, if we do fail, okay, it's a loss of maybe $80,000 to $100,000. It's a lot of money, but money can always be made. But opportunities in life can never be made back. So we thought, okay, let's bet big. Okay, and that year was complete madness, right? But the bet paid off. It could not have paid off, but luckily for us, it did. For the restaurant, that was the first time we got media coverage. First for the restaurant, and then after that, when they found out about the story behind it, School of Thought suddenly had public profile for the first time. But what was interesting on the publishing side, see, we're such newbies, we have no idea what a distributor is, right? But luckily for us, a head of department liked our magazine so much that she told the local distributor of Newsweek when he came around, she said, I don't want to buy your Newsweek anymore. I want to buy this magazine that these guys are producing. And if you are smart, you will hunt them down while they're still small and sign an exclusive distributorship with them. So he turns up at our doorstep, we have no idea what a distributor is, and he said, this is the deal, I have a contract all written out, okay? I will sell and distribute, you guys concentrate on your writing and designing, and this is it. You sell me 10,000 copies at 30% off. Deal? And we were like, in our t-shirt and shorts, right? We're like, yeah, sure, sounds good. And it was unpredicted, but it was fantastic, right? It pushed our companies into a whole new growth that we had never ever planned for, right? And when you push your companies into such growth so fast with owners who are so young and unprepared and no plan, right? We saw things get really, really big, but we also saw things get very, very messy, right? There was, between the years of 2008 to 2011, I'll tell you very honestly, when people say don't run businesses with friends, I don't think it's true. You can run businesses with friends, but you have to be prepared for all of the nitty-gritty of relationships you have to work out, right? And in those years, we had to consistently choose. You choose to be humble, Do you choose to forgive? Do you choose to stay in unity or in disunity? All of these small relational choices that we had to make. And I am very, very grateful that at every point, we as a team decided always to stay in friendship. And it was very, very difficult. Which brings you to the present day. It is 2012. I am 35 years old. I wish I could tell you like, oh, so here's the happy ending, blah, 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 right? But it's real life. It's still going on. I have no idea how this is going to end, right? And just this very year, we started a Food for Thought at the Botanic Gardens, right? And it's a 300-seater restaurant that we are completely unprepared to run. And my accountant sat us down in January and said to us very seriously, you guys have to think about closing down this restaurant right now. If you close it down right now, see, we weren't making enough money fast enough to pay for the cost. And he said, if you close it down right now, each of you directors will just owe $800,000 each. That's about a HDB flat, right? And or if you choose to continue, and if the numbers stay the way that they are, your debt will be even bigger. What do you do? I'm happy to say we chose to stick it out, not knowing what the future is. And the numbers are picking up, and it's doing well enough now that the accountant is not fussing. But you have no idea what's going to happen, right? I tell the story this way because I want you to see that most of us think you get to your dream because you make this one big cosmic choice and this one big cosmic event. And that's wrong. You get to your dream through a sum of small choices made in a big direction. Small, trivial-looking, everyday choices. Do you want to forgive this person or you don't want to forgive? Do you want to bet big? Do you want to bet small? It always comes down to these small little things, and that summation gets you somewhere. The second thing I want to share with you is this. Just this year, we came across a student in our school, and she was writing amazingly great essays, very deep, very skillful essays. And we asked her, how is it that you write so well? Because she came from a very, very humble background. Her dad is what you call a karanguni man, and that's like a door-to-door garbage man, right? And she sends us this picture on WhatsApp, and she says, when I was 13 years old, and I was with my father on one of his garbage collection rounds, we came across a big house, and the big house, they were throwing away all of these magazines. We picked it up. Our family was too poor to have tuition, so that's all I had. And all I did was I read those cover to cover, I highlighted everything, I analyzed the sentences, and that's how I built up my English. I share with you this story because I want to share that your choices matter. There were many times when I was writing that magazine and thinking like, okay, really, is this doing any good? It's just a stupid magazine, right? And I'm like up at 2 a.m. in the morning. The magazines that she had picked up and built her whole English structure from were created in the first 2 years of our magazines. They weren't perfect. Our small choices matter because they open up a larger world of possibilities and larger stories for people, even if we're completely not aware of it. If I had to end off on any message, I would want to end off on this. Your small choices matter. You have a story. Every single one of you possesses a story that you can stand up here and tell the world. So just go out and give your city a story worth sharing. That's all.